If on every ocean the ship is a throne, and for each mast cut down, another sapling is grown, then I could believe that I'm bound to find a better life than I left behind.
There's so much noise in Harmony. I haven't experienced a moment of quiet since the day I woke up 2 weeks ago. I was whisked from my tube to a dark hallway, marching in line with naked clones, my own body covered only because Madame Shale wanted it for herself. Now there's a thought that sends uncomfortable shivers deep into my skin. Everyone is so loud in this city. Everyone is so fucking loud. And yet, far beyond the towers of Harmony, there is a boundless sky of clouds and wind. Supposedly, we used to travel through those skies before the end of the world. We had aircrafts that would fly so far above the cities that they would be dwarfed into toy blocks from the pilot's perspective. Individual humans could not be seen from those skies. Imagine growing up so high above the ground that other humans just stop existing to your eyes. That was the land of planes and birds and angels and heavens. What would you give to live up there in the clouds, where your problems might cease to exist? If no one can reach you, if their voice falls so short of your ears, aren't you beyond the needs attached to those voices? I feel like I'm alone in the clouds. Alone, where everyone is silent. It's dark outside. It's cold in the alley as I lean on the wall, watching Danny stumble from the nightclub and toward his beaten-down wreck of a car. He fiddles with his keys for a moment and bends over. I wait another moment before making my move. Best to make sure he's alone, not like last night's disaster. My head still hurts from where his friend hit me. Once I'm sure that he's alone, I step forward, raising up my walking stick so it doesn't tap on the ground. It's hard to walk without it. But I manage, for a few steps. I manage just long enough to swing it, sending it crashing into the side of Danny's head. He howls, shrieking in pain as he spins to the side, collapsing onto the top of his car. I move fast, gripping him by his hair and smashing his face into the car's trunk. Again, another scream as his nose breaks, leaving blood on his crummy paint job. Finally, I press him to the car, meeting his eyes with my own fierce and furious glare. Though, I hold a friendly smile beneath it. Danny, how good to see you again.
Aria, please, look, about last time.
You left me all alone, Danny, just when I thought there was something special between us.
Oh, come on, Aria, don't be like this.
Listen, Danny. I've had a long day, so let's cut the shit. I had some questions for you last night, before your friend tried to attack me. But now that we've got some alone time, you're going to answer those questions. All right?
And, what were those questions again?
I'd have thought you remembered my questions. I made such an entrance, finding you at the club, smashing your friend's face in with my walking stick, putting my gun to your jaw. Let's see if I can jog your memory. I press the nose of my revolver to his chin and thumb back the hammer. Danny's eyes go wide, and he writhes in my grip, but I only press down on him tighter, kicking his legs apart to keep him off balance. Answer my question, Danny.
You won't kill me.
Won't I? Why's that?
You need answers. You won't risk killing me.
Danny, come now. Of course I can kill you. Then, when we fish your clone out of the tank and inject his memories, he can answer my questions. So, where are Connor and Connor? Where did they get Widget? What are they planning next? Oh, come on, Danny. You and I both know you've worked with the analog movement in the past. You shared co-ownership of that crappy nightclub with them. So where are they?
They're nowhere.
Danny, they can't have all disappeared.
I'm telling you, they all vanished. They cut off communication, so no one's heard from them since the broadcast.
I don't believe you.
They fucked us all. I can't pay my rent without them. Silverstone and Shale are both making moves on my district. They're gone, and every one of us in the districts is fucked.
I roll the information across my mind for a moment, matching it up with the story of everyone else I've shaken down over these recent endless nights. It shouldn't take me so long to work it out, but I'm exhausted. Finally, I sigh and release him, stepping back and leaning heavily on my walking stick. Inside, I'm glad that Danny didn't try to fight back. The revolver wasn't loaded, and I'm not in a state to get into a fight. Go on. Go on home, I murmur softly. I'm just so tired. Danny hurriedly crawls into his car and shoots off into the night, leaving behind the screech of tires and stench of his own piss. No one ever said this would be a glamorous life. It's been 2 weeks since the analog movement made their broadcast to Harmony, and since then I've found absolutely no leads on their location. And believe me, I've tried. General members of the movement weren't hard to find before the broadcast. On my second day after being woken up, I came across a few on the way to Scarlet's bar. Conrad was one. I saw a few of them in the bar that same night. But after the broadcast, nothing. I can't find a single one of them. I've kicked down more doors than I could count. I've asked questions. I've gone undercover, bought drinks, stuck my gun in at least 20 faces, and not one person can tell me where the analog movement's members have run off to. Fidgets tried to help, but things between us have been icy since the broadcast, since I accused her of murder. Since I insisted that I didn't trust her, she's acting like it didn't bother her. She keeps saying, I'm not sad, I am a fidget, and tries to change the topic, but I know she feels it, and it doesn't matter if that feeling is the result of programming or something else. She still feels it. But I still don't completely trust her. Even if she wasn't behind Conrad's death, she's still in my thoughts. She's still on the wrong side of a power imbalance. And since that's not gonna change anytime soon, I shake that train of thought out of my head and return to a task at hand. I need to go see Lancer and Emery. I have an exciting, action-packed report to make, explaining my absolute lack of progress. Far beyond the skies, where the planes flew and the birds danced on the wind, there is an infinite expanse of stars and void and blackness and light and color. It's called space. Humans went there once, so high up that even the greatest cities and buildings were just dots of lights on the vast planet's surface. Imagine going up into space, into the realm of gods and titans and planets and mysteries, where so many things are uncertain. Where the closest people are a world away, is it possible to be more alone than in space? What do our wants and needs and thoughts matter against the massive behemoth scale of the universe? What do I matter? Do I matter? I feel like I'm alone in space. I'm alone. Where everyone is silent. Thank you.
My dears, 2,000 people don't just disappear overnight. At this rate, the only way you'll find out how people disappear might very well be firsthand.
Madam Emery Shale smiles with a calm elegance as she threatens Lancer and I. Her shoulders are loose, balanced, her poise relaxed. Not one muscle in her body tenses, except for the hand curled around the glass of gin. That hand squeezes just tight enough that I can see the liquid within trembling in her grip.
Ma'am, we've kicked down 24 doors and questioned everyone with any connection to the analog movement.
My attention fades away from Lancer as he speaks. It's all old news to me anyways. His hands are behind his back, his posture perfectly rigid and at attention. You'd think he was an action figure. Poorly designed and cheaply built, made of plastic, destined to hold a single pose for the rest of his life. Mind you, if we think of the pose as collapsed on the floor, then that train of thought could apply just as readily to me. They've been planning this for a long time, I find myself saying, cutting through Lancer or Madam Shale. I wasn't paying attention to the speaker.
Whatever it is their endgame with all of this is, it's been in the works for some time. I'm certain of that.
Uh-huh. And without interrogating a suspect successfully, what are you basing this on?
I gesture at the city beyond Shale's gorgeous office. Because 2,000 people don't just vanish into thin air. I allow myself half a smile at Shale, one designed to suggest she go fuck herself. Not without an near impossibly outlined plan ahead of them.
And what is their end game, do you think?
I shrug. No clue. But it wasn't killing Conrad or breaking into our facilities. That was just to piss us off. To let us know we're weak to their methods. And maybe it was to show off their widget AI, but that's the small stuff. The beginning. If they're vanishing their entire network, then whatever their next moves are, they'll be big.
So you're telling me that you can estimate the size of the problem and absolutely nothing else?
It's a trap. I know it's a trap. Don't take the bait, Aria. Yes, that's what I'm telling you. Why did you take the bait, you idiot?
Aria, I've been patient with you. I understand that you've only recently been brought out of your cloning tank. I understand that it takes some time for your faculties to return.
Ah, here it comes. Why did I think I could get through a whole day without anyone bringing up Aria number 5?
Have your memories started to return?
I consider lying, but at this point I don't have the energy for it. And Shale isn't really worth it. No, not a single one. Shale sighs.
Have you been to see a doctor?
I have.
And? What did he say?
Shale's face tightens. I continue. She said they've never seen a clone brought back as many times as me. At this point, my memories might not ever come back. In all honesty, this was the best news I could have been given. Without the shadow of the last Aria's memories returning, I could maybe become my own person. Wouldn't that be nice? Shale's brow furrows at the news, and she sets her glasses down on the table between us.
I'll speak to them. See if we can't pull the backups from our last memories and try to provide them to you. I need you in perfect shape for this, Aria. We don't have time for playing at half capacity.
It takes an incredible feat of energy and self-restraint to not knock her glass off the table, pouring her gin into the beautiful, expensive carpet. And I'm not possessed of a great deal of energy right now. So I flick my hand, swatting the glass through the air, across the room and onto the floor. I don't even look at Shale in the eyes as I turn my heel and stride away. I'll deal with the case in the morning. Right now, I need sleep. Far beyond the space that we can see, beyond the furthest distance our spaceships could take us, even at the height of our power, there is, well, there's more space. What's incredible is how meaningless the blanket of stars spread across the world seems to be. Fidget told me that each of the stars I see in the night sky is so massive that it could fit our entire planet into itself 1,000 times over. And there are millions and millions and billions of those stars. What's the point of them? What do they do with all that space and fire? Do they just burn in the distance? Impossible to reach in their cosmic entirety? And why are they so very small from where I stand? Why are they, in their near eldritch impossible majesty, so meaninglessly finite to me here in my shitty Harmony apartment? Why are they meaningless to me in my perfect billionaire apartment in Madame Shale's building? I'm alone inside a star. I'm alone. Everyone is silent. Samantha is installing a brand new window in the side of the bar when I arrive. She turns to look at me as I approach. It's hard to be subtle when people just have to listen for the tap-tap of a walking stick to identify you.
Aria, hey, I haven't seen you since.
She goes quiet, and I don't even bother with a smile. Since Conrad died very mysteriously, yeah. Neither of us finishes Samantha's sentence for her. We both know the answer, so there's not really any point. Is Scarlet here? I finally ask. Samantha looks away from me, turning back to the window.
She is, but, she doesn't want to talk to you right now, Aria.
She pissed about the rent or something? I say, trying to force out a half laugh. But the deadpan stare Samantha gives me kills the laughter before it even leaves my lips.
Aria, please, if you're gonna stay, that's fine, but stay clear of Scarlet for a while. She's not in a good place right now, and you're the absolute last person she needs to, or wants to see right now. There's a ladder leading up to your apartment that you can use. You used to use it all the time back when you were—
Don't talk about Aria number 5, for fuck's sake! I snap before I could even stop myself. Just once, can we talk without her coming up? What did you even like about her, Sam? She was a bad person. The air between us is cold. Brutal. Samantha turns away from me. She's shaking. She's breathing heavily. I should say something. I don't. I just turn and walk away, heading to the alley, heading to the ladder, to my room. Inside, I take only a moment to stand beside my bed before the weight of the last 2 weeks bears down on me. Before my shoulders sag and my legs give out, my balance dips all the way over and I collapse, crashing down onto my face as the world begins to go dark. Hardwood strikes me as I hit the floor. I lie there for what feels like an hour, maybe more. Every time I try to move my head, the world only spins more and more. Fidget, Lancer, Shale, Scarlet, Samantha. Everyone's pissed at me. Everyone's pissed at me. When I finally open my eyes, ready to try and stand up, the glint of metal catches my eye. It's coming from under my bed, hidden beneath the mattress, hidden at an angle I'd not have noticed if I wasn't on the floor. I reach out and take it, pulling it out of the spring it had been jammed in. It's a harmonica. Beyond the moor is more, and more, and more,
And more, and more, and more, and more, and more, and more. And it's just endless space blinking by us, going so fast and slowly, and I can't tell the difference anymore because it's so incomprehensibly massive, and it's so quiet, and so alone. I'm alone in the moor. I'm alone in the nothing. Drifting in space. Nothing. Alone.
Fidget,
I begin, staring out at the night sky and the vast array of stars surrounding us. Number 5's words vibrate in my head. Come online. There's a soft, beeping sound, and it's almost like Fidget chirps when she comes online. Is it a bird song?
Hello, Aria!
Fidget says.
Sorry, I'm not quite sure why I couldn't reach you, but I'm sure it won't be a problem. What's up?
I learned about aliens the other day.
Aliens?
Yeah, I learned about aliens. Number 5's words shake through every fiber of my body. There's no one you can trust. That's what she said to me. Just you. Just you. I can't keep the tears away this time. I think I know why aliens never found our planet. It's not that we're uninteresting. It's not that we have nothing to offer them. It's not even that we're all that exists. It's a worse kind of alone. They're all out there. And we're here, on our own. And they'll take so long to find us that we'll just be a curious footnote in their history. And that's all they'll ever let us be. They'll never give us the chance to make a difference, to change things. Instead, we just dance to the tune because that's the role, because that's what we've been asked, made to do. Because even though choice exists, some of us don't get to make one. We just exist. Fidget doesn't say anything. I don't say anything. All I can do is play the harmonica. Suddenly, Fidget buzzes. Her voice glitches and fuzzes, and the lights in my room flicker. Someone's breaking through her connection again.
Hello, Aria. I guess you found the harmonica. I didn't think it would take you this long.
I didn't think you'd be speaking English, Widget.
A favor for Aria 5. I'm here to help. But if you want that help after this, you'd best learn Chinese.
Of course. I'll add it to my ever-expanding to-do list.
I suppose that depends on how helpful you're about to be. Why are you contacting me? What did you mean earlier when you said I'd found the harmonica?
Aria 5 hit several trigger codes inside Fidget systems. One was a tune on a harmonica. A tune she played so often that her fingers knew how to do it without the help of a mind.
She built muscle memory so I'd know how to trigger the code, and then hid the harmonica in a place only I'd find it.
Her plan has been moving for a long time, Aria. But the next stage is starting. We are all pieces in her game. A game to save the city.
Wait, save the city? From what?
The analog movement did not kill that man. They were paid to take the blame. There is a third AI in Harmony, one who can access the Mind Weave.
Well, that's not possible. The whole purpose of Fidget is to keep the Mind Weave under control, to prevent access to...
This AI doesn't play by our rules, Aria. And we have to stop her. Find out who paid off the analog movement and report back to me.
And what happens after that?
We all have to play our part, Aria. I have to go now.
Wait, so my part of the plan ends there? She didn't even expect me to help with the rest of it?
Remember, Aria, you can't trust anyone.
And that's it. She's gone. With a click, Widget's voice vanishes, and, except for the dull thrum of chatter from the street, silence takes its place. I stand there in the darkness of my too small room. All I am is a tool, born to serve the unknowable plan of a version of myself long dead, a version of myself who everyone hated. A version of myself who clearly saw little in us that she could trust, given that she won't even let me be important in her own plan. Are you alone, Aria Moon? I ask myself. Fidget is still offline. There's no one else to answer for me, so I just answer for myself. In a universe so massive, everyone is alone. I run my fingers over my knee and hum the song that I played on the harmonica. I remember the name now. It was Space Oddity. Again, I keep humming. It's the only thing keeping Widget's message and Aria Number 5's message from tearing my core to shreds. Planet Earth is blue. And there is nothing I can do. I sing quietly. Fidget says nothing. I say nothing. The people in the streets outside my apartment, for the very first time, say nothing. And in that moment, I am certain of something that I cannot possibly know to be true. But it is something that still remains true. That all across existence, from the streets of Harmony to the stars of heaven, across galaxies and space and planets, for 5 seconds, no one says a word.
Shining in the sky, there ain't a cloud in sight. It stopped raining, everybody's in the play. Well, don't you know, it's a beautiful new day. Smiles with you.